Hello students, welcome to UPG Pathshala. I am Professor D.N. Rao, Head Department of Biochemistry, All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi. Today I am talking about most important two cells in the immune system. These are called B cell and T cell and their development, how they are helping to keep a person healthy. My topic is divided into various categories. One is what is a B cell, how it is differentiated in the thymus, and how the B cell selects and how various types of B cell helps in the human, and how the B cell activated by various antigens, and how the B cell also involved in the pathology of the disease. And you all know that the originator for the all the B cells, all the immune cells is the pluripotent hematopoietic stem cells, and these are the one which comes from the bone marrow. And why the B cell is called a B cell is because the development of this lymphocyte lineage has taken place in the bone marrow. That's why it is called B cell actually. In all the human males, the lineage or development of the B cell takes place in the bone marrow. That's why it's called B cell. And the development of the B cells takes place in many types of fashions actually, and the main function of the B cell is the synthesis of what you called the protective antibodies, as well as it activates the complements, and the whatever the antibody we are measuring, that will help when a person is suffering with any disease or any recent disease or a chronic disease. And the development of the B cell in the bone marrow is really a great event, and that is the one which finally gives rise, or the B cell one which becomes fully developed, it goes to the secondary lymphoid organ, and where it sits there and waits for the foreign antigen to come in.
The main important part of the immunology is the immunity one should develop, and how one will develop immunity is because the body has specialized immune cells, and these are called B lymphocytes and T cell lymphocytes, and the macrophages also, or you call macrophages as antigen presenting cells. These interplay between B cells, T cells, and antigen presenting cells gives rise to a type of immunity which you call it as innate mechanism, adaptive mechanism. Today we are discussing about what are the main functions of the B cells. The B cells are the one type of lymphocytes which are developed in the bone marrow, and as well as in other higher animals also. The main function of the B cell is they produce antibody, and also at the same time they act as an antigen presenting cells in the adaptive immunity. They activate the antibodies which are produced, activates the complements, as well as the allergic antibody that are produced by the B cell is a diagnostic for knowing the allergic reaction also. And what the development of B cells in the bone marrow is a very eventual the episode, and I'm today talking about how this B cell undergoes various the maturation profile in the primary lymphoid organ of the human body, which is called a bone marrow. And the bone marrow is the primary site for the synthesis of various B cells, and initially in the human also, when he is in a fetal stage, the liver or fetal liver is the one of the site where one can see the synthesis of B cells. Later the thymus is one of the main primary organ which is involved in the development of the B cells. If you see, look at various B cell developments, initially it starts with the pre and mature. These are the three types of the developments the B cell undergoes. The pro B cell means it contains only the surface of the B cell contains only the IgM type of receptor. In the case of IgM type of receptor, it has only heavy chain, there is no light chain. And when you come to the development of the pre-B cell, this happens in the stromal region of the bone marrow, under the influence of various growth factors, the hematopoietic stem cells are the one which are delineated into the pro-B receptor synthesis. In the case of pro-B receptor, the light chain is added there and you get a functional IgM molecule. Due to the differential cleavage of the mRNA of both light and heavy chain, you get adenine specificity for giving rise to a IgD molecule. So in the case of a mature B cell, this mature B cell contains both IgM and IgD, and which contains both light and heavy chain and light and heavy chain, and it has identical antigen specificity. This means identical antigen specificity means each individual contains a large repertoire of B cell, and each B cell which is specific for an epitope that are present on a B cell. And once the B cell got matured, then it goes to the secondary lymphoid organs, especially spleen and lymph nodes, where it stays for a long time, and which is waiting for the antigen to encounter. And once the antigen comes in contact with the mature B cell, this becomes a plasma cell, and this plasma cell becomes an antibody producing B cell. And while looking at various markers that are present in the various B lymphocyte populations, starting from pro B cell to the mature B cell, they contain a large number of CD markers, and each CD markers is required for the identification of that particular B cell. And at the same time, the DCMET CD markers that are present in various forms of the B cell, that can be used for diagnosis which form of the B cell we are handling. And secondly, this B cell also, when it becomes a mature B cell and this is come in contact with the self antigen, once it come in contact with the self antigen, that B cell undergoes deletion by apoptosis, and only those B cells which are seen with or which are encountered with the foreign antigen are only present in the secondary lymphoid organs. Stays for a long time, and some of the B cells, starts producing the antibody, they committed in the form of a memory B cells, and this memory B cells stays in a long time in the circulation. When the similar antigen come in contact with the memory B cells, this undergoes proliferation and gives rise to high titer antibody cells.
If you look at the B cell development in the bone marrow, initially starts with the pre B cell, pro B cell, and mature B cell, and finally goes to secondary lymphoid organs. All these pre B cell, pro B cell, mature B cell, this maturation profile takes place in the primary lymphoid organ. Here it is what you call the bone marrow. Under the influence of various growth factors, the B cell acquires two important markers, and these are called IgM and IgD markers. And these IgM and IgD markers are produced by the gene rearrangement of both light and heavy chain. And once the IgM and IgD receptors are present on the mature B cell, they have maintained the same the antigen specificity. In a given individual, the mature B cells are present in zone almost all a large number of repertoire, and each repertoire is connected with a single antigen specificity. And this B cell, once it becomes mature, and then it leaves to the thymus and goes to the secondary lymphoid organ. Before going to the secondary lymphoid organ, this B cell in the immature stage, when it comes in contact with the self antigen, that B cell undergoes clonal deletion or finally undergoes apoptosis and die actually. Only those B cells which are educated with the self MHC molecule and which contains all the necessary signals or necessary molecules on the B cell, then only it goes from the primary lymphoid organ onto the second lymphoid organ and awaits for the antigen to encounter and undergoes proliferation and finally gives rise to the antibodies.
I have already told you the differentiation of the B cells takes place in the bone marrow, and these are called hematopoietic stem cells, and these are the one which under the influence of various growth factors, they converted into either a myeloid or a lymphoid. in the when it comes to the lymphoid, it is the growth factor that differentiates in the hematopoietic stem cells into myeloid series. This myeloid series includes many things which are not the present discussion. The lymphoid series are the one where the B cell and T cell are the one which differentiates. I already told you the B cell when it becomes mature and it contains two important receptors. One is called the IgM and IgD, which contains the heavy chain and light chain. Similarly, you can see the heavy chain and light chain in the IgD also, but both contains the identical antigen specificity. This for a B cell to become a plasma cell, this should contain some important surface markers. These surface markers are nothing but co-stimulatory markers as well as some of the class II molecules. The B cell, when it comes in contact with an epitope of an antigen, these B cell undergoes differentiation and proliferation and it starts secreting the antibody. And once it starts secreting, B cell starts secreting antibody of particular isotype, and there occurs initially you produce IgM type of antibodies. This IgM type of antibodies has to be shifted to other isotopes and isotypes actually. And this conversion of IgM antibody into other isotypes is under the influence of T cell help. This T cell normally produces various cytokines, and these are the cytokines that dictates what type of immunoglobulin has to be made, whether it is IgG or IgA or IgE, etc.
When the B cell is undergoing development early in the thymus, if it come in contact with the self molecules, and this self molecule finally leads to the apoptosis of the B cells, and only few cells are committed to make a mature B cell. And in the B cell also, there occurs a editing of the light and heavy chain. This finally gives rise to extra basis of diversity on the B cell also. Once the B cell is fully matured and it contains the what you called the accessory molecules, co-stimulative molecules, and fully fit for the going into the second lymphoid organ, this naive B cell becomes goes to the second lymphoid organ, where it sits and waits for the foreign protein to come in and encounter. Once the B cell sits in the second lymphoid organ, it waits for the foreign antigen to come. And once the foreign antigen sits on the receptors of the B cell, then the B cell undergoes the maturation as well as the differentiation and proliferation. And that B cell finally gives rise to an antibody. For the first antibody when the B cell gives is the IgM antibody. When the B cell want to give other isotopic antibody, it requires the help from the T cell in the form of various cytokines. Once the T cell help is there, then only the B cell which is producing the IgM can produce IgG antibody or IgE antibody or IgE type of antibody. Once the T cell won't produce the cytokines, then the B cell undergoes apoptosis, and the B cell is what is called allergic B cell, or what you call it won't respond to producing the antibody, etc.
During the developmental stages of B cell synthesis or B cell that is synthesizing the antibody, I already told you the B cell requires always help from the T cell. Unless that help is not there, the B cell never proliferate and start secreting antibody. Especially with the polysaccharide antigens, the B cell produces only IgM antibodies, and it never produces a memory response, or after the encounter with the same polysaccharide antigen, it never produces the switch in the immunoglobulins to IgG, etc. That is the reason the synthesis of immunoglobulins by the B cell is under the control of a T cell. And in the early stage of a human being, you produce a large number of antibodies. As the age moves and once you become older, the synthesis of antibodies by B cell comes down. And this is one of the area why the older people gets infection much more easily, is because their B cell is not able to synthesize much of the immunoglobulin because they have the reduced number of B cell in their peripheral circulation, etc. For the B cell to undergo proliferation, the B cell has to contact with the T cell in the form of many surface co-stimulator molecule that are present on the B cell as well as in the T cell. The B cell should contains a class 2 molecule. At the same time, the B cell also should contains the various CD markers, and these CD markers has to be recognized by the counterpart ligand that are present on the T cell. Once the counterpart ligand and the receptor binding takes place, then only the B cell undergoes the proliferation, and this leads to the synthesis of antibody. That's the reason B and T cell association is very important for the synthesis of immunoglobulin as well as the classes mechanism of the immunoglobulins, etc. At the same time, if you can see the various pathogens, these various pathogens contains signature molecules which are called the LPAs, and single standard DNA, double standard DNA, RNA, etc. And these are the signature molecules which are recognized by the B cells in the form of toll-like receptors. There are almost all 11 to 12 toll-like setups are present in the humans. These toll-like receptors are recognized by the signature molecule that are present in various bacteria. And this leads to the activation of the B cell. And this activation of the B cell by the toll-like receptors as well as the T-cell growth factors leads to the expansion of B-cell and finally leads to the synthesis of antibody molecules. Once the B-cell starts synthesizing the antibody molecule, after some time the B-cell switched off, and some B-cells undergo apoptosis, and some B-cells become memory B-cells for a long time. And these memory B-cells, when in future they come in contact with the same antigen, they undergo proliferation much more strongly, and they produce a very high level of antibody synthesis. That's how the memory B cells helps and keeps the person always in a good healthy condition by circulating in the various secondary lymphoid organs, etc. If you see the various pathological events that you can see in various diseases, etc., the B cell, even though it starts synthesizing immunoglobulin specific for many antigens that are coming from the pathogen, these antibody, instead of helping the host for killing the pathogen, they help in multiplication of the bacteria, and at the same time they help in the synthesis of various cytokines that are become inflammatory. This inflammation leads to the various autoimmune diseases, and the best example being the type 2 diabetes, where the T cell helper coming on the B cell that produces cytokines. These cytokines are the one which are responsible for the inflammatory reaction. This inflammatory reaction leads to the insulin resistance in the pancreas, etc. If you see the various pathological events that you can see in various diseases, etc., the B cell, even though it starts synthesizing immunoglobulin specific for many antigens that are coming from the pathogen, these antibody, instead of helping the host for killing the pathogen, they help in multiplication of the bacteria, and at the same time they help in the synthesis of various cytokines that are become inflammatory. This inflammation leads to the various autoimmune diseases, and the best example being the type 2 diabetes, where the T cell helper coming on the B cell that produces cytokines. These cytokines are the one which are responsible for the inflammatory reaction. This inflammatory reaction leads to the insulin resistance in the pancreas, etc.
During the B cell maturation, I told you, once it starts secreting the IgM antibody, and if it want to switch the IgM to other isotypes, it requires help from the T cell in the form of various cytokines, then only it can switch the antibody to other isotypes. This will differentiate early infection versus the chronic infection also. Once the antibodies are generated, this antibodies causes the agglutination or precipitation or killing opsonization or killing of the all this foreign pathogen is encountered by these antibodies. These antibodies also a lot of help in activating the complement cells at the same time. And one more important thing is, even though the antibodies are helping a person to be in a very good condition, very healthy condition. If there is an excess generation of antibodies happens, that leads to various pathological events. The best example is the type 2 diabetes or type 1 diabetes, where the presence of antibodies activates a large number of complements as well as the cytokines. That leads to the inflammation of the tissue, and this inflammation of the tissue leads to the what you call the resistance to the particular hormone or resistance to a particular type of activity, etc. That's the reason. What is more important, I told you actually, the B cell, though it produces helpful antibodies to the host by killing various foreign antigens or foreign pathogens, the large excess of this generation of this antibody is not good actually, because it may lead to the inflammation and finally disease. And at the same time, one produces anaphylactic antibodies, and these anaphylactic antibodies are nothing but leads to is a person is suffering with a parasitic infection, or if a person is suffering with a allergy, etc., it produces what you call IgG4 type of antibodies or IgE type of antibodies. These are the wrong antibodies. From this one can find out whether a person is suffering with a allergy or when a person is suffering with a worm infection, etc. That's how the various, by measuring various concentration of the immunoglobulins at different situations, one can find out whether a person is suffering with a what you call allergic reaction, or a protective antibody, or a non-protective antibody. Sometimes the antibodies also causes the what you call the multiplication of bacteria or viruses inside the host cells also. That is also a dangerous phenomena where you do not have a control to kill the pathogen, etc.
I already told you the role of B cells in antibody synthesis and how it helps the person into a healthy nature. But there are certain instances where B cell activation leads to autoimmune diseases. I already highlighted to you, when a B cell is undergoing differentiation in the bone marrow itself, that B cell, when it comes in contact with the self antigen, that B cell undergoes apoptosis and clonally deleted. But there are certain instances when the foreign antigen or the self antigen, when it is heptanically modified, when it come in contact with the B cell, and this B cell undergoes the proliferation and gives autoantibodies. Autoantibody generation is one of the major factor that leads to the various autoimmune diseases, and these autoimmune diseases causes the destroying of the various tissues, etc. That's how the instead of B cell is producing a help to the healthy individual, same B cell also can produce unwanted antibodies that causes various deleted effects in the human beings, etc. I
already told you the importance of B cell and its development in the thymus, and its passage to the secondary lymphoid organs, and where it is waiting for the foreign pathogen to come in, etc. What is in all these cases, the B cell is one which is helping the individual from a healthy atmosphere, and the antibodies are mostly circulated in the bloodstream, where extracellular antigens are the one which reads the antibodies and finally causes the elimination of the pathogen, etc. And that's how the primary and secondary organs are thought to help for developing a good antibody molecule, and these antibodies are helpful to the host. Many times when an immature B cell come in contact with any foreign antigen, that never induces the synthesis antibody, because the B cell never had the what is called the co-stimulator molecules or accessory molecules. So for a B cell to produce an antibody molecule, it must contain the accessory molecules or the co-stimulator molecule. This is very important. And second thing is ligation of these co-stimulator molecule or accessory molecule with the T cell is very important for the release of cytokines. Then only the B cell can switch the antibody molecule, which is really helpful to the host. If the B cell is producing the what you call unwanted antibodies, that leads to sometimes the what you call the activation or the multiplication of the pathogen inside the host cell, etc. Sometimes under various abnormal condition, the B cell start producing abnormal amount of antibodies. These abnormal type of antibodies not good actually, because this is the what you call it, that may leads to sometimes autoimmunity also. This autoimmunity finally leads to the destruction of the tissue, and finally once a person is end up with an autoimmunity, it's very difficult to cure the patients. Of course, there are a large number of the medicines or chemotherapy or monoclonal antibodies are available which can treat the patient in autoimmune disease. For a B cell to produce optimal type of antibodies, it must produce, it must contain certain markers, and these markers are nothing but CD10, CD90, 20, etc., etc. And these markers are very important because for a T cell to recognize these markers, at the same time the peptide that is coming out from the processed antigen has to be bound onto the receptors of the B cell, that finally undergoes proliferation, give rise to the antibody. So the presence of the costimulatory molecules, the accessory molecules, full development of the B cell which contains IgM and IgD, all these things are very important for a B cell to become a mature B cell and finally lead to the antibody synthesis. The already I talked to you the function of the B cell, as well as the how the B cell makes an antibody, how it is useful to the host, and sometimes how it is dangerous for some of the autoimmune diseases. Today we are talking about the T cells actually. T cells, why the name got it is because its education has taken place in the thymus. That is the reason the T cell, the maturity, the immature T cells, when it gets matured at the thymus, that's why it's called the T cells. T cell always, the difference between the B cell and T cell is T cell always recognize the processed antigen, whereas the B cell recognize unprocessed antigen which has a some secondary structure, etc. The T cell undergoes development into various forms in the thymus, and once it is undergoes development, the T cell carries a receptor, and once it carries a receptor, when the antigen binds on the T cell mature receptor, it undergoes activation and differentiation and finally produces various cytokines. And you have different types of T cells which has a different biological function. And if there is a small amount of T cells, or the T cells are not properly matured in the thymus, you get a T cell disorders that finally leads to the various congenital diseases, etc.
The T cells are the most important cells in the body. Why they called T cells? Because B cells which undergoing differentiation or the progression into the mature B cell in the bone marrow, the T cell undergoes the what you call the maturation in the thymus. That's why it's called thymus derived T cells. The T cells are involved in the what you call the cell mediated immunity. The main difference between a B cell and T cell is B cell produces antibody, and these antibodies circulate in the bloodstream and they attack the extracellular pathogens, whereas T cells are mostly involved in the cell mediated immunity, where some of the pathogens they multiply inside the cells, and antibodies are not available for killing of the infected cell. So in this case, these T cell which produces cytokines, and these are the cytokines which are involved in the activation of other immune cells, and these other immune cells finally recognizes the infected cell and kills the infected cells, etc. That's how the T cell help the people which makes them healthy throughout their life. The T cell recognizes a peptide which bounds to the MHC molecule, and once the peptide is bound to the MHC molecule, then only the T cell recognizes. Without the presence of MHC molecule, the T cell never undergoes or proliferation to produce a cytokine. So the key feature for T cell activation is the peptide MHC interaction, which is crucial for the activation of the T cell. Once I told you the peptide generation, there are certain cells in the body which are called antigen presenting cells, which includes dendritic cell, macrophages and B cells. These are the ones, they capture the foreign antigen by various immunological ways actually. That includes the phagocytosis, pincocytosis, etc. Once the antigen is internalized inside the APC, this APC causes a degradation of the antigen. And finally, this degradation leads to the peptides or the epitopes. And these peptides are then bound to the self-MHC molecule. And finally, it comes to the surface of the APC and where in common contact with the T cell for the T cell proliferation, etc. Before going to the T cell proliferation, I must say two types actually. This is class 1 and class 2 molecules. The class 1 molecule is the one which gives the peptide to the T cell which contains the CD8 as a phenotype. The class 2 molecule are the one which gives the peptide to the T cell which contains the helper or the CD4 phenotype. The CD4 phenotype leads to the synthesis of the antibody, and the CD8 phenotype leads to the cytotoxicity of the cell cells, etc. When you come to the structure of the MHC class 1 molecule, this contains the MHC molecule contains the four domains, and these four domains are called alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. And this is all contain a single polypeptide chains. To this is attached another polypeptide which are called beta 2 microbubble. This entire structure is called class 1 molecule. And this class 1 molecule always recognize a peptide of less than 10 amino acids. This is very important, unlike your class 2 molecule which recognizes peptides of higher amino acids, where only the class 1 molecule recognizes the peptides of almost 10. To see the structure of class 2 molecule, this entire class 2 molecule is made up of four domains. These are alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2. And these four domains constitutes the MHC class 1 molecules. And when the peptide is, when the protein is undergone the processing by the APC, the epitope that is coming from the APC delivering the T cell, which bounds to the MHC molecule, should be of a higher amino acid length. I already told you the class 1 molecule recognizes only 10 amino acids, whereas in the case of class 2 molecule, it recognizes more than 15 to 20 amino acid length, and they are all very highly flexible actually. The class 1 molecule is not flexible. It always wants 10 amino acids, whereas class 2 molecule wants always 15 to 20 amino acid length. If you look at the T cell development, I already told you the origin of the T cells are also coming from the hematopoietic stem cells. And these hematopoietic stem cells, through blood, it reaches the thymus. In the thymus, the T cell undergoes two types of selections. One is called the positive selection, and second is called the negative selection. In the case of positive selection, they recognize the self-MHC molecule. Once the T cell recognizes the self-MHC molecule, and they becomes the positively selected, and those which doesn't recognize the self-MHC molecule, they undergo apoptosis and finally they deleted. Once it undergone positive selection, then it goes to the other chamber of the thymus, and they come in contact with the self-antigen molecules or self-peptides. Once they come into the contact with the self-peptides, some T cells undergoes death, and finally they leave from the thymus and goes into the circulation. And that's how the T cell, when it is immature before it enters into the T cell, and becomes mature when it comes from the thymus and enters into the T cell. During that process only, it acquires either a CD4 phenotype or CD8 phenotype. And if it becomes a CD4 phenotype, then it becomes helper T cell. If it acquires a CD8 phenotype, then it becomes a cytotoxic T cells. The positive and negative selection is very important, because this is the key for the T cell to become the naive T cell, which finally comes in contact with the various foreign pathogens and undergoes proliferation and produces the cytokines, etc. Once it becomes a mature T lymphocyte, it acquires many CD markers, and these CD markers are very important both for the activation as well as for inducing the signal transduction, and finally releases various cytokine, etc. If 100 immature T cells goes into thymus, only 5% of the T cell becomes the mature T cells and finally goes to the secondary lymphoid organs and where they come in contact with the foreign pathogens, etc.
During the development of the T cell receptors on the surface of the T cell, actually, I already told you the T cell undergoes before by maturation by having a positive selection and negative selection in the thymus. Positive selection means it contours and encounters with the self HLA molecules, and the negative selection means it encounters with the self antigen. Once these two processes are over, the T cell, which is a mature T cell, contains either alpha beta or gamma delta T cell receptors. This is because the gene rearrangement that has taken place at the thymic level contains either of the two receptors. And mostly the alpha beta is a classical peripheral blood derived T cells, and these are the one which helps for the proliferation of T cells and finally leads to the death of the encountered pathogen, whereas the gamma delta T cells are the present mostly in the peripheral and to some extent in the tissue level as well as at the stomach level and intestine level, and these are the one when they become gamma delta they encounter those pathogens which are coming from the mouth or from the nose, etc. So that's how the alpha beta and gamma delta T cells have been dichotomized, etc.
The T cell receptor, which is a membrane bound, either it is alpha beta or gamma delta. In normal healthy people, the alpha beta T cell receptor constitutes around 90%, whereas the 10% constitutes the gamma delta. The peripheral blood where T cell occupies contains major the alpha beta, whereas intestinal mucosa, intestinal epithelia all contains the gamma delta T cells. All these receptors contains the CD3 and other accessory molecules, and all constitutes the T cell receptor. This accessory molecule, which are, though they are present on the membrane, there are certain accessory molecules which has a long cytoplasmic tail, and this contains tyrosine containing tail, where the tyrosine undergoes proliferation, phosphorylation for producing the T cell activation condition. The T cell, when it undergoes or when it binds with a specific antigen with its through its receptors, there occurs a large cascade of events, which includes the some of the important proteins that comes in contact with each other and causes the phosphorylation. And once they get phosphorylated, some of the kinases, phosphatases, which are released into the cytosol, they further activate some of the transcription factors. These transcription factors then translocated from cytosol to the nucleus, and once it is translocated to nucleus, they bind on the gene of interest and activates a particular gene. For a, already told you, for a T cell to undergo proliferation, the T cell has to get two important signals: peptide MHC molecule, which binds with the T cell receptor, and at the same time the T cell also should contain some of the costimulatory molecules, and these costimulatory molecules has to share with the APC, that finally gives us a strong signal. What are these costimulatory signals? On the T cell you can see a large number of costimulatory molecules which are called CD28, CD152. At the same time, the APC also contains and CD80 and 86, and this association between the APC costimulator molecules and T cell costimulator molecule is very important for the full proliferation of the T cell, etc.
Once the T cell undergoes the differentiation and comes to the peripheral blood, it acquires three markers or four markers sometimes. If it acquires a CD4 marker, then it becomes helper T cell. Why it become a helper T cell is, it helps the B cell to produce antibody, because helper T cell is the one which produces cytokines which are beneficial or growth factors for the proliferation of the B cell to secrete the antibody. The cytotoxic T cell is the one which is recognized by using a phenotype called CD8 phenotype. This T cell is very important, especially intracellular pathogens that are multiplying inside the cell. They recognized by cytotoxic T cells. Once the cytotoxic T cell recognize the pathogen multiplied cell, they inject certain granules, these are called perforin and granozyme. And these perforin and granozyme, when it goes inside the cell, then the cell becomes leaky and there is a difference in the osmolarity. The difference in osmolarity causes the lysis of the cell, etc. And there are certain cells which are called memory C T cells. Already I told you, once the T cell function is over, some T cells are committed for the memory and they sit in the second lymphoid organ. And in future, if they come in contact with the same pathogen, that memory T cell undergoes proliferation much more abundantly. The most important is the regulatory cells. These regulatory cells are the one which are involved in the tolerance as well as to avoid autoimmunity. This is most important because if there is a down regulation of the T regulatory cells or up regulation of T regulatory cells, a person is end up with a lot of autoimmunity and he won't produce the tolerance, etc. And another type of T cells are natural killer T cells, and these are also an important T cell because these T cells recognize the phospholipid or the glycolipid antigen that are present mostly on the mycobacteria. Once they recognize this glycolipids, these natural killer T cells, they proliferate and produces both types of cytokines which are beneficial to the host, etc.
You already know that T cells are the very pivotal cells which induces cell mediated immunity, and sometimes when there is a defect in the T cell function or there is a number of T cells are reduced in the human being, then you end up with a lot of the immunodeficiencies, etc. There are large number of immunodeficiencies are known where when you have a T cell defect or number of T cells are depleted in the circulation, you end up with a lot of diseases, and these are either autoimmune or these are the what you call the congenital, etc. In the main function of the T cell defect is the one it causes a patient vulnerable to many pathological diseases, etc. And since the T cells are defective, they are not able to help the B cell or they are not able to help the other SSS cells to kill the pathogen, and finally they end up with a large number of diseases, etc. And this is T cell disorders. One cannot repair it because people are started attempting to clone the gene of T cell defects, and they want to introduce into the zygote itself, and they failed actually. Hence the T cell defect is a major problem, and once the T cells are depleted from the circulation, and you end up with various bacterial diseases, parasitic diseases, various autoimmune diseases, etc., etc.
If you see overall the adaptive immunity that are encountered by T cells, it is an important T cell because the T cells are the one which recognize the infected cells which are multiplying inside the cell, and these are the one which are recognized by the T cells and causes the lysis of the infected cells. And the T cells always recognize a processed antigen, and this processed antigen comes in the form of epitopes, and these epitopes has to be given to the T cell receptors along with a self HLA molecule, very important actually. Once the HLA molecule doesn't deliver the processed antigen to the T cell, then the T cell never produces the T cell response in the form of cytokines. And I already told you, the T cell which bears the CD4 phenotype, they are the helper phenotype, and the T cell which produce have the CD8 phenotype, which produces a cytotoxic response. So when the antigen binds on the T cell receptors, and binding of the antigen induces a cascade of events, these are called signal transduction events, and these transduction events finally causes the release of various cytokines in the bloodstream, and these cytokines are the one which activates the other cells of the immune system to kill the infected pathogen. The already I told you, the T cell undergoes the two types of education in the thymus. One is called the positive selection and negative selection. This positive and negative selection finally gives rise to a maturity cell. And once a maturity cell leaves the thymus and goes to a secondary lymphoid organ containing various the accessory molecules or as well as the co-stimulatory molecule, that T cell become an effector T cell, and that this effector T cell is the one which produces the right cytokine and the right molecule which are helpful to the host. And after it does its job, actually the T cell is committed to become a memory T cell, and this memory T cell are circulated inside the cells. And once they are present inside the cell, if they in future if they come in contact with the same foreign pathogen, this T cell undergoes proliferation and produces the cytokine, etc. Once the T cell doing such a wonderful job as far as maintaining the immunity in a good person, in a healthy person, this same cell, if the T cell, if it is not undergoing proper differentiation or activation inside the thymus, then you get a small number of T cells, or the T cell never acquires the proper markers, then the T cell becomes a defective T cell. If a T cell is become defective, you end up with a larger number of autoimmune diseases which are difficult to treat the patient, actually. So the T cell which is mature, which contains the accessory cells markers as well as the co-stimulatory markers, and which is fully competent, that T cell has to be give rise to the important point. Otherwise, if it is a defective T cell, that finally leads to the what you call autoimmune diseases. So this is how I complete my T cell property. I'm very thankful to two of my students, who are Dr. Priyanka Verma as well as Dr. Sujata Pathak, who helped me in making this module successful. Thank you very much.